questa. I will try to be slow in these last lectures. Last one after lunch. So, okay, so I try to convince you that the dynamics in this disordered model can be more complicated than in standard ferromagnetic models. But actually, the main evidence that we have about this dynamical behavior of disordered system comes either for numerical simulation. So there are experiments, but interpreting experiment is really not easy. While if you want to measure something directly, like a correlation function, a response function, the best thing you can do is to run numerical simulation. And on the other side, we have a few, very few solvable models, and I just want to sketch you how the spherical PSP model has been sold many years ago, and what are the key features of its dynamics that can be connected to thermodynamics. And then I will end the lecture tell you that maybe this is not all the story, so there is much more to understand. So why the dynamics of spherical, fully connected model can be solved? Well, essentially because variables are real variables. So you can write Langevin dynamics. What is a Langevin dynamics? You say that the derivative of the configuration with respect to time is related to, on one side, there is one term which is a deterministic term, which is the derivative of the Hamiltonian computed. Is this working?
Yes.
The Hamiltonian
is, well, more or less. It works when I do this.
So you take the derivative of the Hamiltonian with respect to the variables, and you compute a time t. And then you have a random noise term, which is usually, you take a Gaussian random noise. So this, again, is a vector. And this Gaussian random noise is mimicking the effect of the thermal fluctuation, so thermal noise, okay? So essentially, you have this, say, deterministic part, the system, in absence of noise, try to minimize the Hamiltonian. But if you have a non-zero temperature, on top of trying to go down in energy, you also have thermal fluctuations that makes the dynamics to be a stochastic dynamics. And this term is usually is a Gaussian variable of zero mean and variance which is twice the temperature and is delta correlated in time. Okay? So this is the Langevin equation. And this means essentially that the thermal fluctuation that the system receives at any time is uncorrelated from the past. So, and this factor temporal here is fundamental in order to have in the large time limit, this system, if there is no ergodicity breaking, samples the Gibbs probability distribution at temporal t. Okay? So this factor 2t is such that, on the long run, this system will visit all the configuration according to the Gibbs-Boltzmann distribution of a system in contact with a thermostat of temperature T. Okay? So let's take this as a bona fide dynamics. So obviously, it's not what happened in a real system. In a real system, the dynamics is a quantum dynamics and blah, blah, but we are here on the classical realm, and we want to keep classical, so we are still working with the classical variables. And if the spin are easy spin, this, well, is not well defined, but if the spins are spherical spins, so real variables, this differential equation is perfectly well defined. Eventually, if you want to enforce the spherical constraint, you need to add a term either in the Hamiltonian or here. Usually, you add it here. This mu enforces the spherical constraint. So at each time, you choose the right mu such that sigma at time t satisfies the spherical constraint. And everything depends on time, so then you can solve this by discretizing time, and blah, blah, blah. Actually, what people did in the late 70s is to solve this model using the generating functional method, the one originally invented by Bartis and Jerose, which has been specialized to the case of disordered model by De Dominicis and Peliti. And actually, I don't want to explain you the method, but just to tell you that essentially you build a probability distribution of trajectories. Each trajectory depends on the noise, so you have a probability distribution over trajectories, and from that you try to understand what is the essentially. I will show you. Essentially, you want to simplify, since you are in a fully connected setting, solving n couple equation, because these are n couple equation, because you have the full configuration is unfeasible, and you want to convert this equation in a equation for a single degrees of freedom, but a more complicated equation. And this can be done with the generating functional method, because actually what you do, well, let me put this term into the Hamiltonian. So the Hamiltonian I'm using is the usual Hamiltonian. And then if you want to plug also this term into the Hamiltonian, it's enough to add one term of this kind to the Hamiltonian, such that when you take the derivative with respect to sigma, you get the term enforcing the spherical constraint. And so you recognize easily that this is just like adding a Gaussian more term in the measure in order to enforce sigma square equal to 1. And then eventually you can also add, this is integrated over time. You can also add an external field that couples with the spins, okay? Such that when you take derivative with respect to H, one spin goes down in the measure. So you can add all these terms. So we don't have to look at this. And then you essentially you want to have a probability distribution over trajectories of these spin variables. And you would like doing things very sketchy, just to give you an idea. The idea is that this probability distribution is what you get if you integrate out the noise with this Gaussian measure of zero mean and this variance. So here there is the integration over the noise. The integration is over all times. You have to think that at each time you have a noise. So these are an integration over all the realization of the noise along a trajectory, the probability which is Gaussian of the noise. And then you want to enforce that the Langevin equation is solved. So you want to enforce a delta function between the Langevin equation that I can rewrite as sigma dot, which is the time derivative, plus the derivative of H with respect to sigma, minus the noise. Okay, and in H, in the new Hamiltonian, I put also the spherical constraint, this term that will be useful in order to take derivatives and compute mean values of sigma. So essentially, you try to do this, and when you try to do this, you want to integrate over the noise. So what you do is the usual trick. You take the delta function, you exponentiate it, you introduce new conjugated variables, sigma hat, in order to make the integral representation of the delta function. And at the end, so once you, in the end, what you get is a probability for sigma. So what? Let me write the expression for the what is called the generating functional. This is nothing but the integral over sigma of the probability over all the trajectory. These are all trajectory. I don't write the time and the time index. And if you use this representation for P of sigma and you do some work, at the end you can write this in terms of the original variable, the conjugated variable that enforces this term here, and you integrate over the noise, and you end up with something which is let me call it this way. Where d naught is the variance of the original variance of the noise. So d naught is given by the original variance of the noise, which is given is a delta function now. Okay, I write this way because I want to show you what happens when you average over the disorder. And if you, in principle, this quantity is one because you are just integrating a probability distribution, so it seems a rather useless expression. But actually, it's not because you can add some more terms here in order to. So you already have in dH d sigma a term with the external field. So from here, you see you have one term which is I sigma hat, and the h d sigma, you have a term with the external field h. Now, for symmetry reason, you can add in this expression also a term of this kind. And at the end, you want to send all these external field to zero because they are not in the original problem that you want to solve. They have been added only such that when you take the derivative of z with respect to h, one sigma hat goes down. And when you take the derivative of z with respect to h hat, one sigma goes down. Okay? But at the end, you always compute everything with h and h hat equal to zero. Okay? So once you write this generating function, so the generating function, you have to think that is an object which depends on h and h hat, because you over all the other variables we are integrating, okay? And thanks to this, if you are interested in computing, for example, the correlation between the configuration at time t and the configuration at time t prime, this is one of the objects we are interested in because this is c, t, and t prime. And the average is over all trajectory, so all the ways the noise affect the dynamics of the system. You see that this can be computed by taking the derivative twice with respect to h hat, such that one sigma goes down, another sigma goes down. There are e factors, so I'm very sketchy. I will not take care of all the minus signs. You have to be a little bit more careful than what I'm doing things now. But this essentially is proportional, so we save all the minus factor. The double derivative of z respect to h hat in t and h hat in t prime, and then you compute everything in h and h hat equal to zero, because those terms were introduced just for the purpose of taking derivatives. And the same you can do for computing the response, because the response is the derivative of the mean value of sigma time t with respect to a real field at time t prime. And so again, since the average value of sigma at time t is just the derivative of z with respect to h hat time t, this is proportional, so I don't have all the I factors around, is the derivative of h hat time t, the derivative of h at time t prime. And then you compute everything. So this just to convince you that once you compute this function z, which is the generating function, for arbitrary external fields and conjugated fields, by taking derivatives, you can compute all the quantities of this, what we call R of t and t prime. So in particular, you can compute correlation function, response function, okay? So the question is, can I compute this generating function in a disordered model? Because if I'm now in a disordered model, the Hamiltonian contains disorder. So I can do this for any disorder sample, but actually I would like to compute something averaged over the disorder. Correlation function and response functions are observable, are quantities which are called self-averaging. What does it mean? If you compute the correlation function on a very large system, on two very large systems, they mostly coincide. While in disordered model, there are other things, they are not self-averaging, so you have to be careful because, for example, as we saw, the canonical partition function is not self-averaging, while the free energy is. Correlation and responses are self-averaging quantities. So you can take the average of you want to take the average of C over the disorder, and so you can take the average of Z over the disorder. This looks strange because Z looks like a sort of partition, a dynamical partition function. So you say, how can you take why in the dynamical approach you are allowed to take the average over the disorder of this, which is a sort of dynamical partition function? This is because essentially, and moreover, there is one more analogy that if you work it out with a little bit carefully, you realize that the time in this expression is playing more or less the role of the replicas in the replica calculation. So the analogy is strong, but still you can do the average of Z, essentially because by definition, when you set all the fields to zero, Z is one. It doesn't fluctuate from sample to sample. Okay, so in H equal to zero, by definition, Z is one. So there are no fluctuation from sample to sample. So as long as we are close to zero, you are safe in taking the average of Z. Another way of seeing it is that you see here the probability distribution over the trajectory is an exponential term, but you don't have the normalization factor below. Actually, the normalization factor is Z itself, which is one. And so you don't need replicas in order to take the Z, which is in the denominator, and compute it correctly. Okay, so there are different ways of seeing it, but essentially, I find more illuminating the fact that for any sample, Z is one. So really, in this case, the generating function does not fluctuate so much from sample to sample. So you can take the average of Z. This means that if you take this term here, the Hamiltonian may have a deterministic part and a random part. In the model that we saw, there is always only a random part because the Hamiltonian depends on the J. But in general, you may have a deterministic part and a random part. And you want to take the average over the random part. And what happens when you do this in general, and so also in the models we are interested in, all this derivation about the the dynamical equation derived through the generating functional formalism is very well done in the lecture note by Castellani and Cavagna. You can find it. So when you compute the so let me split this dh d sigma in two terms. I call it L naught of sigma is deterministic part, and Lj of sigma is the random part. So in general, the Langevin equation is sigma dot plus L naught of sigma plus Lj of sigma is equal to the noise. Okay, so this is the Langevin equation. And these are the terms, these three terms appear here. So once you want to do the average value of Z over the disorder, you have some terms which do not depend on disorder, which is this and this, and also L naught. So you have some terms like minus 1/2 sigma hat d naught sigma hat. You also have a plus I sigma hat sigma dot plus L naught, which do not depend on the disorder. And then you have one term which do depend on the disorder. So you have one more term here times exponential of I sigma hat Lj of sigma, and you want to average this over the disorder. You can do this average, and it should not be surprising that when you do this average, this is computed, let me write this more explicitly, this should be intended always as the exponent, an integral over the times. So when I write this expression, I mean sigma hat at time t, Lj computed on the configuration at time t. Okay, so I'm assuming that all terms have a contraction as an integral over the, a contraction over the indices. Here the indices are the time indices, so it's an integral over the time. So it's not surprising, since here there is some disorder. When you take the average over J with the Gaussian measure, as usual, what you get is the square of this term, because this term is linear in J. So this term will be J times something. You integrate with the Gaussian measure for J, and what you get is something proportional to X squared. And since X is all this term but J, when you do the square, you are coupling different times, because you have an integral over t, an integral over t prime, and so the system will result in an effective coupling between different times, which was not present before. Before, we had all this exponent computed as an integral of a single time. So here, the action was local in time, so only variables interact at the same time. Here, integrating out the disorder, we couple different times, exactly as it happened in a replica calculation. At the beginning, replicas were independent. Then you average over the disorder, and replica get interacting. Okay, very, very similar. And the final result is that this expression here, will have many terms, but the important one, when you do the average over the disorder, you get one term sigma hat, the one which depends on sigma and sigma hat, sigma hat, and another term which is sigma hat L1 of sigma and sigma hat. So what's happening, among many other terms, what's happening is when you I will write this term explicitly now so you can see them, but essentially when you integrate out the disorder, luckily enough, you get some terms which are of the same kind of those that were already present in the action. So for example, you can prove, also you can assume, because otherwise you don't know what to do, that there is no term sigma sigma, which is not present here. You see there is a term sigma het, and so D1 will be a renormalization of D0. And there is a term sigma het with this L1, which will be a renormalization of this L0. So essentially the average over the disorder induces new terms in the action, and these new terms are no longer local in time. And so the final result, let me write it for now for a p-spin model. So this more or less the way to proceed. Now you do really the computation where Lj is the Langevin term for a p-spin model. So now let's move to the model we would like to understand what happened. So I can show you the actual equations. So now let's take the spherical p-spin model. And so once you realize that the average generating function is of the same kind as before, with only these interaction terms which are changed, you can claim that this average effective generating functional is the one corresponding to an equation with L1 instead of Lj, and the noise, which is no longer correlated with D0, but is correlated with D0 plus D1. Okay? So once you understand this, you say, okay, so this something general, let me write it here before going to specific. This new equation, this new generating functional, is the one that would correspond to a Langevin equation where I do have a sigma dot plus L naught plus L1, so a new Langevin term, equal to a new noise, because now the noise is different, its color is no longer delta correlated, so let me call it xi, where the correlator of xi is no longer d naught, but is d naught plus d1. And I will show you that in general, L1 is no longer a local term in time. So you get two modifications of your Langevin equation because of the average over the disorder. On one side, the Langevin equation gets, this is a memory term, because now here you have two times, is what you get when you take the square of this term. Yes?
And this is why we have to integrate over time that.
No, this just, this expression means the integral over time. Ah, because since the beginning we had we have to impose the delta function at each time. So at the beginning, when you compute P of sigma, you want to impose, this is a product over all times of the delta function of sigma dot plus L naught minus eta, and then you want to integrate this over eta. these are products. So once you exponentiate this, you get essentially an integral over time of sigma hat of time sigma, and then you integrate over eta. So everything is integrated over time, but is local. Once you do this, L1 is no longer local in time, because it's, so it's the effect of averaging, which makes different time interact. So this L1 now is a memory term depending on the whole history, and the noise is no longer delta correlated, in the sense that while D naught is delta correlated in time, D1 is not, for the same reason why L1 is not. So in D1 and L1, these are non-local term. In time, eh? In time. Okay? So this is what happened in general. It is pretty similar to what happened with replicas. When you take the average over the disorder, replicas start interacting. Now, here you take the average over the disorder and times start interacting. So this equation now is no lo- is, has a memory term, is no longer a Markovian process. Previously, it was a Markov process because it was not depending on the past. Now, it depends on the past. And moreover, the noise is no longer delta correlated. So also, the noise is more complicated. So if you take this formula and you apply to the spherical PSP model, what you get is that this equation, let me write it a little bit more explicit so you see how it changes from the original equation. You get the following. You get the derivative of sigma respect to time is equal to minus mu of t sigma of t plus the integral between 0 and t in dt prime sigma t and t prime in sigma t prime. You see, this is the memory term. I will give you an explicit expression for sigma, but in the equation, let me write it in a compact way. Okay? Plus psi of t. So with respect to the original Langevin equation, now you have this term, which is non-local. Okay? And moreover, the correlator of psi average value of psi is always 0, but the correlator now has the original term, which is delta correlated in time, plus a new term, which is no longer delta correlated in time. So these are a correlated noise. These two effects, the memory term and the correlated noise, are usual when you do the average over the noise, over the disorder in a stochastic equation. Okay? Yes? What does it mean? Because you see, when you compute this, like, it plays the same role as the force bringing the system in a specific direction in order to minimize the energy. But now this force is not computed on the configuration sigma at time t as before. It's computed on all the configuration sigma at time t prime between 0 and t. So essentially, is considering all the past trajectory in order to compute the force, the direction where you have to go. Originally, this term originally was dh d sigma computed at time t. So originally it was something that you compute on the configuration at time t. Now it's something that is integrated over all configuration at previous times.
It's like a retarded
time. Exactly. Exactly. So it's no longer Markovian, because what you do at time t, it depends on all the history. So now this process is not Markovian. And let me write also the explicit expression for sigma. So sigma of times TNS can be written as R TNS. And if you want to do it in the more general spherical mixed p-spin model let's do it on the specifics. So this p minus 1 half C T and S P minus 2. Otherwise, you have to take the second derivative of the function F that defines the mixed p-spin model. And the correlator of the noise is given by P half C T S P minus 1. So you end up with a new equation, which is more complicated. But the advantage is that now the disorder has been averaged. So what does it mean? It seems that this equation now no longer depends on the disorder. Why? Because we assume correlation responses to be self-averaging. So essentially, the equation satisfy by any large enough system. So this is no longer depending on the disorder. So we end up with a single equation, longer a disorder equation, but more complicated. But this holds for any large enough system having that Hamiltonian, that random Hamiltonian. Okay. Moreover, we notice that from this equation, one can easily derive the equation for correlation and responses. I will not explain to you how to do, but once you have the derivative of sigma, the equation for the derivative of sigma, if you want to compute how the correlation changes in time, it's not very difficult because you have all the ingredients to do it. So for example, if you are interested in computing the derivative of the correlation function with respect to S, well, since the correlation function is just the mean value of sigma t sigma s, you have to take the derivative of sigma s with respect to S. So you take all this expression, which is the derivative of sigma at time s with respect to s, and you plug it inside, and at the end what you get is something like minus mu c of tns, which is nothing but this term here, plus the integral between 0 and t dt prime sigma t and t prime C of T and S, because again, when you do the correlation between sigma T prime and sigma of S, you get correlation C T S, plus you have to work a little bit more in order to understand what happened to the correlation between psi and sigma, but at the end, what you get is the integral between 0 and S, dt prime d t and t prime r s and t prime. And the analogous equation for the response is the following.
Let me put only the relevant terms.
So you see that what you are doing, essentially, you are closing your equation on the two quantities that you are interested in, correlation and response. Because you had an effective equation for sigma, but since at the end you want to compute correlation and responses, you can go from that equation to explicit differential integral equation for C and R. The only thing that you need in order this equation to be closed is the expression is an equation for mu, which is still not known, but you can get this very easily from the fact that CTT is always 1 by spherical constraint. And so taking the derivative with respect to T of this quantity is 0. And from this, you can derive easily an equation for mu of T, which essentially you find to be equal to T plus the integral between 0 and T in the T prime, dt t prime r t t prime plus the integral between 0 and t dt prime sigma t t prime c t prime t or t t prime. C is symmetric. Okay? So they may look difficult, but actually you are solving exactly the dynamics of a model by solving two differential equations where mu is completely given. Now, remember that you have to solve for two times, so this is not an easy object because essentially you have to compute this correlation for any pairs of times, and this is given by the integral over the past. So these are not equations easy to solve, but still you can write in a half a blackboard the equation for any p-spin model, because now here I wrote the expression for the pure p-spin model, but you can write it for any spherical mixed p-spin model. So this very compact expression. Now the question is, if I solve this equation, what I get? Okay, now we got the equation, which are exact. In which sense they are exact? Because we derived them under the, we derived this equation and I haven't done all the computation explicitly, but in the computation, there are some subtle points, so you have to take n very large, and this is why the equation at the end decouples the sites. So we couple the times, but this equation is the same for any sigma. So the sigma I, sigma j, all the sigma are exactly the same equation, so you just solve for one sigma. Because once you remove the disorder, as usual, all the sites become equivalent. So the sites are different because this J is different from the other one, but once you average over the J, these are n spins connected everybody with everybody, so they are completely symmetric equivalent. So as usual, when you take the average over the disorder, sites decouple. But in the computation, you actually use the fact that n is large. And so the idea is that these equations are fine as long as n, the size of the system, goes to infinity, and the time is large, but much smaller than n, or much smaller than exponential in n. So you don't, in some sense, the system has to remain in a situation where, for example, suppose that you take a model that eventually thermalizes and falls down like in the coarsening model we are discussing this morning. You have a first coarsening regime. Eventually, the system thermalizes either plus or minus. That thermalization step and falling down in a deep minimum is not well described by this equation. So this equation are describing a regime where the system is very large and times are large, but self-averageness must hold while and when the system is thermalizing, the correlation function is no longer self-averaging, because when you are close to do the jump into the deep hole, the time at which you make the jump may fluctuate a lot from trajectory to trajectory. So while the first part, everything is very smooth, and if you take a system large enough, if you take two systems large enough, they will behave the same, practically the same. At the end, when they will thermalize by a rare fluctuation, the time when they do the jump may be very, very different. And so at the end, the correlation function is no longer self-averaging. The two differ. Okay? So, what can we say about this equation? So, solving this equation is not easy. So, even numerically, even if they are very important, I know just two, three works in literature solving explicitly this equation for very long times. So it's not very easy to do. But we can say something interesting analytically, and this is what I would like to show you now. So suppose that, first of all, this equation should be valid at any temperature. So in principle, they are valid also at very high temperature. At very high temperature, we don't expect to have aging. We expect everything work very nicely. And so if we put ourselves at a very high temperature, we expect the system to eventually enter in a... we expect the system to eventually reach an equilibrium, a stationary time translation invariant behavior, because at high enough temperature, everything should be very, very nice, and the system eventually reaches the time translation invariant regime, where FDT holds. This is the solution that has been computed by Crisanti, Horner, and Sommers in the first 19s. In this situation, you can simplify the equation by saying that this is just a function of the difference of time. Sorry, I'm using a different notation with respect to the previous lecture. In the previous lecture, the first argument was already the time difference, while here the two arguments are really the two times where you compute the correlation. So eventually, if TTI holds, the correlation will depend only on the difference of the times. And the same for the response, will depend only on the time difference. And these two functions, which depends only on one time, these two, they are related by the fluctuation dissipation. In terms of sigma and d, it's easy to see that the FDT can be written as d dot is equal to minus t sigma. So also d and sigma becomes a function only of the time differences. And so the fluctuation relation, the fluctuation dissipation theorem essentially put a relation between response and correlation between d and sigma. So you plug these ansatz inside, and obviously the equation will become just one equation, because once you compute the correlation, you also have the response, so it's just one equation. And this one equation, one more property that you use in order to derive this one equation is the fact that a high temperature, you don't expect any ergodicity breaking, so there is no ergodicity breaking, which means that the limit for t going to infinity C of t is zero.
So you want to forget the initial configuration eventually, okay?
If you use this relation and that limit, you can take this equation and convert in a single, much simpler equation, which is this one. C dot of t is equal to minus t C of t minus 1 over t, the integral between 0 and t in ds of f prime, which is p half C of t and s p minus 1, C dot of s.
So this is the equation that should be solved by the correlation if all these hypotheses holds true.
So given we are very tired, now we do the coffee break, and then I will show you what happened to this equation in the after the coffee.
Okay, so we can start again. Many people are missing. So this equation here, in the literature you can find it also in the so-called the schematic Mott coupling theory, MCT, Mott coupling theory, and has been used a lot as an effective description of dynamics of systems like glass forming liquids, so systems that do undergo a very strong arrest, a very strong slowing down when you change the temperature. And I want to show you now that actually this equation has indeed a dynamical transition where the shape, the solution C of t changes dramatically, okay? And this we will see is exactly the dynamical temperature of the spherical p-spin model. So, well, this at least is an equation in just one variable, so you can even integrate it much, much easier than the full equation which are in two variables. But since we are just interested in the large time behavior, so I would like to understand that when and how this system is relaxing to zero, and when this condition fails, which means there is ergodicity breaking. So I'm interested in the behavior of C of t for very large t, very large time. So let me take a time which is very large. And if the time is very large, you see here we have this t minus s, sorry. This is just in, we are using time translation invariant. This is c t minus s, sorry. So what you notice in this integral is that if t is very large, you can compute the main contribution from this integral comes either from when s is close to zero. When s is close to zero, you have a contribution which is non-zero because at the beginning the correlation decays with a slope which is non-zero. But this term is small because it's C of t. Well, it's small. Is C of t, and if ergodicity breaking holds, is going to zero. On the other hand, when s is close to t, you have that this term is large because it's
C of 0 is 1, so the correlation is large when S is close to T. But then, if you are reaching an asymptotic regime where C is not changing anymore, the derivative is very small. So what happens is that at the two extrema, one of the two terms is very small, the other one is different from 0. In the middle, you can see that both are very small. So essentially, this integral gets the main contribution, which are small contribution, because they must be compared with C of T, which again is going to 0, and C dot, which is going to 0. So all the contribution are small from the two extreme of the integral. In the middle, the contribution is even smaller. So let's split this integral, assuming that either S is small, so it's close to 0, or either T minus S is small. If you do this, you can integrate exactly this integral. You can see that so this integral here, P half C T minus S P minus 1 C dot of S has roughly two contributions. One contribution when S is close to 0, you can take T minus S constant and equal to T. So the first contribution is S close to 0 and much smaller than T. So this term is essentially constant. So it's a P half C of T to P minus 1. And the integral in the S of C dot of S, now is integrable. It's just C in 0 minus C in T. Actually, C in T minus C in 0. So this C of T minus C of 0, which is 1. So let me write 1. Okay. So this integral comes from S much smaller than T. And then you have a second term. I will put it here, where now T minus S is much smaller than T. So S is roughly T, and this part is small. And so you can write this as C dot of T, because now in this term T minus S is much smaller than T. So S is roughly T, so you can put T here and bring this outside, and then you have an integral between you change variable, because now T minus S is the variable which is small, so you integrate in tau, where tau is T minus S, and so this integral is just the integral in tau of P half C of tau. It's a number. Okay? Let's call all this number A. I don't care about the value, it's just a number. Okay? So if the integral has been solved in this way, now you see that this term C dot times A, you can take it and bring in the other side, is just putting something in front of C dot. And the other term is proportional to C of T, and you leave it on the right hand side. And so you end up with an equation of this type, 1 plus A over T C dot of T is roughly equal, because we solved the integral in this way, to the first term remains the same, minus T C of T, and the second term now is this one, so it's plus P half C T P minus 1 CT minus 1. Sorry, there is a minus 1 over T. So, sorry, this is 1 minus CT divided by T. I have to multiply by minus 1 over T. Okay, we are almost done. Now, the correlation function is a function which always decreases. So, C dot of T must be always non-positive. Okay? because C is a decreasing function. So if the left-hand side is non-positive, also this quantity must be non-positive, okay? But now look that all this expression is just a function of C of t. So we are asking a function of C of t to be strictly non-positive. And so if you try to solve this, well, you can write it here. Essentially, you have to solve this in... so you want to ask all this to be non-positive. And if you reorder a little bit the terms, you can write it as... you can write it as, yes, you can write it as 1 minus C of t divided C of t p half C of t to the p minus 1, much smaller than t square. Okay, this is a function of C of t. I drew it for you. I will draw it for you. And I draw this function here, and it looks like between 1 and 0, it starts like this. Well, it depends on the p value, but it does something like this. So what is telling you that all this construction is consistent if the temperature is higher than this function for any value of C, because you want the correlation to go from 1 to 0. And essentially, so if you take a temperature T square, which is here, is fine. All the construction is consistent until the very end. Notice that the quantity that we are plotting, so if you take this minus this, is proportional to C dot, to the rate of decreasing of the correlation. So what happens is that, so this difference is proportional to C dot, which means that at the beginning, it goes down very fast. Then you reach a region where the slope is much smaller, and then eventually you go down again very fast. What happens if you decrease the temperature? If you decrease the temperature, at a certain point, you reach a value of the temperature where you find the first intersection. At this point, you have that C dot is zero. So essentially, the correlation does not decrease anymore, okay? Because the difference is proportional to C dot. So what's happening here is that first, this condition is no longer satisfied, and in practice, C dot is zero, so the correlation gets stuck. It's no longer going to zero. We call this value QD for obvious reason, and we call the value of the temperature where this happened TD square, for obvious reason. And since the expression for this function is very, very easy, because now let me write in terms of, so this function I'm plotting here is 1 minus x over x p half x to p minus 1. Essentially, you have to look for, so let's do it p minus 2. It's much simpler. You just have to find the maximum of this function. Okay, you do a derivative, and believe me, so you have to take a derivative, set it to zero, and then you can compute very easily QD and TD. And what you get is that QD is equal to P minus 2 over P minus 1, and TD square is the usual p minus 2 to p minus 2 to p minus 1 p minus 1. So what we got from the thermodynamic computation. So what's happening? If I draw this correlation function at some temperature before, above the dynamical temperature, the C dot is always different from zero, although around the QD is already getting slower. So the picture you should have in mind is the following. C of T starts from 1, suppose that this is the value of QD. If the temperature is larger than TD, it goes down, it becomes a little bit slower around QD, but still goes down until the very end. You decrease a little bit more the temperature, and here it goes down. It takes more time, because now the slope is smaller, and it will take more time. And once you reach TD, it gets stuck. So these two are T larger than TD, and this T equal than TD. When it gets stuck, all the hypotheses under which we derive the equation are wrong. And so you have to look for a new solution. But essentially, well, since you can do this for any temperature slightly above TD, the equation was valid. And so we can also take the limit and understand that QD is really the value where it gets stuck. So this is essentially the reason why at TD we have to forget about the parametric solution. This is ergodicity breaking. This means that if you start from any configuration at equilibrium, the system, which means at TD it will be in one of the spin glass states, the correlation is not able to go to zero. So you will remain constrained in a region whose similarity with respect to the initial configuration is QD, and eventually if you go even lower in temperature, the plateau value increases and everything becomes even more more stuck. Okay, so this is one of the main things I would like to show you from the dynamics, because this somehow justifying all the picture that I described to you based on the TAP equation, the replica calculation. Because the parametric state was always there, and so you have to justify why at a certain point the assumption underlying the parametric solution is wrong. And this is the justification. Ergodicity is broken, and so even if between TD and TC the free energy is by chance, exactly because the right computation has n equal 1, so it's not a chance, it's the fact that you have exponentially many states and you still haven't reached the condensation, so the point dominating the thermodynamics has m equal 1, and for m equal 1, the spin glass free energy is equal to the parametric free energy, so it's not chance. There is an explanation, but in that region, the free energy of the right solution is the same as the free energy of the parametric solution. The parametric solution must be abandoned below TD because ergodicity is broken. Okay. The only other feature of the so if you assume TTY, that's all. Essentially, you have one equation, you can solve it in very easily, and you understand that there is an ergodicity breaking. Now, if you want to go below TD, assuming equilibrium, assuming that everything is ergodic, is wrong. So you have to forget about this simple equation in one time variable. You have to come back to the equation in two times. Can we say something about the general solution of those equations, luckily enough for the spherical p-spin model, yes. So if I put now myself below TD, I have to come back to the equation for CTNS RTNS. Okay? I really have to solve this equation. These equations are not easy to solve numerically, but there are some, again, key feature that can be computed analytically. And the reason, the main hypothesis that allows to solve this equation is an hypothesis that allows you to uncouple the regime of short times and the regime of very large times. Otherwise, if these two regimes were coupled, you are forced to solve all the dynamics in order to understand what happened at large times, and this is impossible. You have to do it numerically. But analytically, the main reason that allows to make some prediction about the large time behavior of these two quantities is the fact that the large time behavior becomes uncoupled from the short time behavior. So whatever you do at a very short times, so you kick the system and the system is crazy, eventually if you let it relax for the rest of the time, at very long times it will reach a solution that is uncoupled from what happened at the very short times. And this allows you to close the equation only on the very long time part, and this allows to make some analytical prediction. And this idea of having an uncoupling between short times and long times can be somehow formalized has been formalized by Kuliandoro Kurchan, that derived this equation and the first solution in the last time regime of this equation in 1993 by the term weak long term memory. What I mean by this weak long term memory essentially means there is a long term memory, so it's not that the system has a short term memory. If you have short term memory, you are Markov-like. No, here the equation has very long-term memory because the kernel, sigma, depends on the correlation. So if the correlation decays slowly, sigma decays slowly. And the correlation of the noise, D, depends again on the correlation and the responses. So if correlation decays slowly, also the noise is very long correlated, but weakly long correlated. And you can see this if you plot the response time TNS as a function of the difference of times. So S is smaller than T. So this quantity is usually negative. So I want to see how the system feels at time T, what happened at time S. Okay? And you can do this plot for different times times S. So this will look like this. This for a quite short time S. So this essentially is zero. So when this is minus t, because it's when s is zero, okay? So this is the initial time, okay? But if you increase s, it does like this. If you increase even more s, it does like this. So what's happening? You have a region here, you see is independent, so s is growing in this direction. So you see that there is a region of very short time differences where the response is sensibly different from zero, which is reasonable. You remember what happened a few steps before, okay? If someone gives you a kick 3 steps before, okay, you feel it. But you're interested in understanding what happened on the very long past. Do you remember the very long past? Because we have these long-term memories. And so the response is essentially what is telling you how much do you remember what happened here, okay? And you see that increasing S, which is what you would like to go in the limit T and S much larger than 1. So you are interested in what happened when S is large. You see this is decreasing. So for a fixed value of the time difference, the response is becoming smaller and smaller. So while the system is becoming more older and older, it remembers less and less what happened in the past. So this is good, and this can be... So in particular, the two main quantities that one is interested in when you try to solve this equation for C and R, taking all the integrals and splitting the integrals in a part close to the first extremum of integration and the second part close to the other end of integration are integrals of this kind. You are interested in integrals of this kind, limit between So you see, this is the integral up to now is time t, starting from a time which is t minus t bar. Okay? So essentially, you take t bar step in the past, and you ask yourself, if I choose t bar large enough but finite, say 1,000 steps, I'm taking all the integral of the response, so can I ignore what happened before t bar? The answer, unfortunately, is not. What I mean is that this integral, for any value of t bar, finite, is always smaller than the limit of t going to infinity of the integral between 0 and t in the S of R t and S. Is always strictly smaller. This means that for any large value that you want to consider in the past, if you keep a finite memory, so this is equivalent to keep finite memory of the past. Because t bar is the length of your memory. If you keep a memory of size t bar, you forget something. You are disregarding something because this integral is always strictly smaller than the integral over all the past. So this says there is long-term memory. You are not allowed to truncate your past. You have to keep all your past. But luckily enough, and this is what allows you to actually solve the equation, it's also true that for any finite value of t bar, the limit of t going to infinity of the integral between 0 and t bar ds r t and s is 0. So what does it mean? What happened on the first t bar steps is forgotten. So you see, it's a very delicate situation. You are not allowed to keep only a finite time memory, but the very early transient, the very first steps, are forgotten. Obviously, in the middle, there is a lot, okay? So this means that you can disregard what happened on the first t-bar steps, but still, so even if you are not allowed to keep a finite memory, you are allowed to disregard what happened on the first finite steps. And so if you wait long enough that all the initial transient happen, then you can close the equation. Essentially, these two properties, in particular this property is in some sense is negative. It says it's not a Markov process, otherwise it would be a Markov process with a memory term of length t bar. It's not a Markov process. Still, the memory of the past is weak enough that you can close, you can solve the equation by separating the long time and the very short, the short time in the integrals. And so, thanks to this property, you can solve the integral. And what you get, and what did Kuliandro Kurchan got when they solved this, is essentially what I was already telling you for coarsening process. So you can indeed split the system, the correlation in a stationary or FDT part, which depends only on the time difference, T now is the time difference, plus an aging part, which depends, on both times, and in practice, well, let me write this way for the moment, and T waiting plus T and T waiting. And essentially, what happens is that when you solve the equation for this part already became stationary. So it reached the last time behavior. And so doing the usual plot, essentially, this FDT part is what brings you somewhere. We can call this the plateau value or the Q Eder Anderson value. Let me call the plateau value. We are doing dynamics. The plateau value. And so FDT is only responsible for the first part. And when you solve the second part, not only the first part is already stationary, but all what happened on the very first times, thanks to these properties, are irrelevant for this part here. So you can work on this part disregarding the first one. And so this part is the one which age, and you want to understand how it aged. Thanks to this, so you can remove from all the integrals the short time part, and for this part you can use a scaling that you eventually plug into the equation, and now the equation simplifies because once you have a scaling relating the two times, they are no longer equation in two times, but they are equation just in one quantity, which is the scaling involved in the two times. And this is what... yes? Yeah.
You could split the right-hand side on an integral from 0 to t minus t bar, and then from t minus t bar to t.
But then you have to decide when t diverges whether t bar stays finite or diverges with t. Here, t minus t bar, this is diverging. Okay. So this is the key point. The key point is that the time is diverging. You have to decide whether you want to have a second time diverging with t or the second time staying finite. If the second time staying finite, okay, we don't care it. If diverges with t, we care it, but we have to be careful because in that situation, yes, so essentially, you have to take, if you take t bar, which is, say, r times t, so it diverges, but it's much smaller, then also this quantity diverges, and so you... This is the right scaling. So this is just to say that any... So it's like say, okay, I have a Markov process, but the memory term diverges with time t. Okay, so it's still untractable. And so you need that property in order to close the equation. And so once you close the equation, what you get is the last result I want to show you, is that both the C aging and the aging part for the response can be written. So C aging of T T and S. Now both T and S are very large, and we forget about the finite time. This can be written as the plateau value and a ratio of two functions, h of s divided h of t. And the same holds for the aging part. This can be written as h prime of s divided h of s and another scaling function. So you see that while these two are function of two times, these are function of just one quantity. So thanks to this scaling, we are now reducing effectively the number of variables from two to one. And so we can write, you can plug this into the equation, solve the equation and find a relation between calligraphic C and calligraphic R. And what you find in particular for the P-spin model, two things. You find that in order to be able to close the equation, two things must happen. Cp must satisfy this equation. Cp is, P is for plateau, let me call it plateau, otherwise you think it's P of the P-spin, equal to 1. Maybe you don't remember it, but this is exactly the equation that we wrote for the threshold, for the overlap of the threshold state. So for the overlap of the threshold state, we have Q threshold square P minus 1 half Q threshold P minus 2 equal to 1. So what we are finding is that this aging dynamics below TD, so the system is out of equilibrium. There is no way to have a connection with thermodynamics. And actually what we find is that the system is doing aging as if the first part, you have a relaxation within a state which has exactly the same overlap as the threshold states. And then you do aging. So you are not really inside the state, but the sensation that you are very close to threshold states is there. Okay? And then you also have the other properties is useless that I told you, because I should spend 10 more minutes in order to connect it to thermodynamics, but essentially there is this one more property that tells you that the relation between correlation response seems to be related to the P of Q that you compute from thermodynamics. So there is a connection between this quantity and a relation between C, calligraphic C and calligraphic R that you measure in the aging regime. So all these results seems to suggest the following picture I want to leave you, which has been, say, proved in the spherical P-spin model that we hope to be more or less valid also in other models, because it's the simplest, I don't want to say it's the only, but it's certainly the simplest way to understand what happened to the last time dynamics in disordered systems. And so the picture we have, let me plot in terms of energy and temperature. So here we have, energies should be negative, so let's do a plot which is meaningful, otherwise you would complain, and I agree. So energies are negative. Here you have the paramagnetic energy that, if you derive, is minus beta over 2, okay, so it's diverging. Then we have TD, TC. Up to here, the free energy is the same, so also the energy is the same, but below, we know that the thermodynamic changes, and so we have to follow this minimum state, but we also have threshold states, okay, that they meet the parametric. This is energy, it's not free energy. Now it's really energy, what you measure when you do Monte Carlo simulation. And so what's happening to the dynamics? The dynamics seems to be ergodic here. So up to this temperature, it is it all the space. At this point, if you start at equilibrium, ergodicity is broken. And if you start out of equilibrium, so you really do aging, the system seems to relax. You start from very high energy, relax to threshold states while doing aging. If this is true, and in the spherical PSP model is true, you see that this is extremely convenient. You don't have, the next time, you don't have to solve this nasty dynamical equation, differential integral equation in function of 2 times for very long times. You do the replica calculation on the back of the envelope, because at the end, once you know how to do replica calculation, it's really in the back of the envelope. You compute threshold states, and you know where the system ends. Okay? So if someone asks you, what happened to this nice system if I cool it down, or if I do a quench to a temperature below the critical temperature, and your prediction is it will go to threshold states. It will do aging on threshold states, because these threshold states are not really very well-done states, because remember, above threshold state there are no minima. Below threshold state there are minima. At threshold state, they don't look really like minima. They look like marginal objects, or objects which are very splatted, as you say, open, is not really a minimum, because slightly above, there are no minima. So it's an object which is like a manifold, and the dynamics seems to approach the manifold and surf on these threshold states. So if this works, it's fantastic, because we can understand something about the out-of-equilibrium dynamics from thermodynamics. A well-done thermodynamics, because these are metastable states, so we know we have to count from computing the sigma of F, but still it can be done. The problem is that this picture is fine, you have to keep in mind because it's useful, but it's too simplified. There are many other models where first we don't know exactly how to compute threshold states. Maybe you have to break the replica symmetry twice or infinite times, so it's not so easy. There are models where the dynamics seems to go below what we expect to be the threshold state, but maybe the computation was not perfect. And in general, when you start playing a little bit with the temperature, so for example, you thermalize the system here and then you move the temperature, you expect the system to follow threshold states, it doesn't seem to do so. So all what I told you for the spherical pure PSP model is exact, but as soon as you move from that model and you move, for example, to the mixed PSP model or to the easing model, easing PSP model, so variables are no longer spherical variables, easing variables, everything becomes much more complicated, and there is still a lot of work to do in order to understand what happened really to the out-of-equilibrium dynamics of disordered system, and try to make the connection between dynamic and thermodynamics tighter, because this helps a lot, because we don't want to solve the dynamical equation. So I leave you with this, and I give you a lot of information. I hope something remains, and until tomorrow, I'm still here. I know that you have to study, but if you have questions, come to me. Thank you.